everyone. In this video, I am going to explain about the steps of surveying procedure. Before moving to the steps of surveying procedure, let me explain about the color codings for the surveying. First, the brown pencil is used to mark the metallic portions of the denture base. The metallic portion of the framework is marked with the help of brown pencil. Then, blue pencil is used to mark the denture base area or the denture base extension where the acrylic portion will be extended. The red color is used to mark the any interferences or any relief has to be done or any contouring of the crown has to be or the tooth structure has to be done is marked with the help of the red pencil. It is outlined with that. Then the solid red is marked with the solid red is marked to indicate the rest seat area on rest seat area of the design. The black pencil or carbon marker is used to mark the survey lines, the tripod markings, then the tooth to be replaced or the rod wire retentive arm when we are using for the retentive clasp. So starting with the procedure of surveying. For surveying procedure, first of all, the first step is to examine the occluded diagnostic cast. In this occluded diagnostic cast, the three things we need to note down. First one is the proposed rest areas has to be indicated by a short vertical line on this land area. For example, if in this case, if you are going to place a rest seat on a cingulum rest seat on this canine and also the distal, the proximal rest seat on the occlusal rest seat onto the premolar, then on the land area, the single line is marked to indicate the rest seat on this tooth. Now, the significance of marking this line onto the land area is that if in any case we are going to change the placement of the rest seat, then this line can be easily scraped off without altering or changing the tooth structure. The second thing to note down with this occluded cast is that to check any interferences which are present during the occlusion. For example, if this lower second molar, the mesobuccal slope is interfering to the upper tooth for a proper occlusion, then that area has to be marked with a red, has to be outlined with a red pencil. For example, if this cusp is interfering, then it is marked with this red line like this. Then in a later stages, this area has to be relieved. Followed by which the third point to evaluate is examination of the lingual aspect of this occluded cast. Now the lingual aspect is examined to check any clearance which is needed, the occlusal clearance which is needed for the cingulum rest or any extension of the metallic portions. So using a black pencil from the rear of the cast, a line is drawn on the lingual surface or the palatal surface of the maxillary tooth. This maxillary anterior teeth, for example, here I'm marking the line onto the palatal surface of tooth. Then this will by taking the incisal edges of the lower tooth as a guide. So this line shows the incisal limit of the proposed metal extensions. For example, the any metallic extensions of the framework. So as I have marked over here the lines, so till this point only the metallic portion of any of the framework has to be extended. Above to this it should not be extended. Now these were the first step to examine the occluded diagnostic cast. Then the second step is indicating any other type of the tooth replacement which is desired with the help of pencil. Now for example, if you are going to replace the any missing tooth by tube teeth, facing, metal ponting or reinforced acrylic ponting, then the symbol has to be marked onto the soft tissue surface of that particular area. Now for example, if I am going to replace over here over here, if I'm going to replace a metallic tooth, then for each of the tooth, the marking has to be done onto the soft tissue surface underneath that area. For example, if I'm going to replace here two teeth, then two times the marking has to be done. Then, if you're going to use a denture teeth for a denture base, then the symbol is not indicated. This was about the second step for marking the tooth, the type of the tooth which is to be replaced. The third step is the most important step, where we have to determine the path of insertion. That is, the horizontal tilt of the cast is determined. For example, first of all, to determine the horizontal tilt of the cast, the cast is placed at a zero tilt or a basic tilt or at a horizontal tilt, where the long axis of the tooth structure will be parallel to the vertical arm and the occlusal surface will be parallel to the bench top. Now, with this cast, the cast at this position can be tilted to four directions, that or in a two planes, that is the anterior plane, the posterior plane, right tilt or the left tilt. For example, I am tilting it over here. The tilt can be adjusted by this ball and socket joint, where it is loosened first. This is the anterior tilt of the cast, then the posterior tilt of the cast, the right tilt or the left tilt. So the procedure is started by locking the cast at a 0 degree tilt. Now after the 0 degree tilt has been done, the cast is placed at a 0 degree tilt, followed by which the four factors has to be kept in mind to determine the proper path of placement. So in that, the first factor which has to be determined is the guiding plane, the retentive undercut, aesthetic and interferences, or the if you are going to replace any implant processes or implant fixtures, then the long axis of implant has to be considered for this path of placement. Starting with the first factor, that is a guiding plane. So it is determined by inserting a analyzing rod onto it. So to determine a guiding plane, first of all, this with the help of this analyzing rod, the proximal portion of this tooth has to be determined. What do you mean by guiding plane? Guiding plane is a parallel, is a two parallel surfaces of a teeth adjacent to the edentulous area. Now, this guiding plane has to be given or determined at a three areas, that is the proximal portion, the bracing arm and the retentive area. And with this, for example, if I'm going to determine a guiding plane for this mesial aspect of both the canines, then it may be acceptable for this canines. But along with that, the guiding plane for this canine for this premolar also has to be determined. So we can see over here, the guiding plane is not that much acceptable. That is, the guiding plane is short. It is the shank of this, the analyzing rod is touching only the marginal ridge area of this premolar tooth. So here the guiding plane is compromised over this premolar, and it is okay with these two canines. So for that reason, the cast has to be tilted at a desired position, so that at an equal the equal guiding plane we can achieve at all these three abutments. Now this can be, as I said, it can be tilted with the different tilts. Now we can see here there is an acceptable guiding plane over all the tooth surfaces. Now this guiding plane, if it is not acceptable at this tilt, then it can be recontoured by either doing enameloplasty or by placing a surveyed crown onto this tooth structure, if it is at all required. Otherwise, we can alter with the enameloplasty only. The second factor which has to be determined for the proper path of placement is the retentive undercut. Now, retentive undercut should be examined at the mesiobuccal and the distobuccal line angle, or the mesolabial or the distolabial line angle for the abutment tooth for a retentive arm. Now, this undercut is, again, as we have seen with the guiding plane, the retentive undercut alters at a different tilt. So with this tilt, we need to see that whether we can achieve the adequate amount of undercut is there at this desired tilt. Now, once the undercut is determined, then the aesthetic factor is also to be considered. That is, as much as possible, we need to place the retentive clasp arm at the distobuccal undercut, distolabial undercut, or the distobuccal undercut areas, because this the mesobuccal undercut area is more visible. So hence, to provide more aesthetic appearance, the undercut design has to be placed more distally. So for that reason, with the help of tilting the cast at a desired tilt, we can alter the undercut area for an aesthetic reason. Then is the interferences. For example, in a maxillary arch, there are several interferences such as the palatal tori, any bony prominences if seen. So if for example, this is a mandibular cast, so in case if we are having any palatal tori onto this premolar region, or any bony prominences is seen over the labial portions, or the lingually inclined teeth or proximally or the buccally inclined teeth is there, then that has to be properly evaluated and the desired tilt has to be determined. So this was all about the determination of path of placement and removal, where we are looking for a four factors, that is a guiding plane, retentive undercut, aesthetic and interferences. So this was the third step for surveying procedure. Then again, the fourth step is also important, where after the final tilt of the cast has been selected, it must be recorded so that the cast may later be repositioned precisely. So this procedure of recording the tilt of the cast is known as tripoding. Now, what is the purpose of tripoding? In a simpler terms, we do tripoding just to copy or just to duplicate the tilt which is given to this cast, the diagnostic cast, to the master cast. So tripoding can be done by two methods. It can either be done by an anatomic tissue surface tripoding, or by art portion tripoding. So I am placing an undercut gauge over here. The tissue surface tripoding is done at the anatomical area. For example, I am doing for this the vertical arm has to be fixed. So I am adjusting the surveying arm over here, making it a fixed, so that the tripod marks can be placed at this fixed position. So as I said, there are two ways of tripoding the cast. So it can be either be done at this tissue surface area, or the anatomic tripoding we can say, or on the art portion of the cast, or we can say the land area of the cast. So two methods for tripoding. So I am doing here an anatomical tripoding on an anatomical surface. So here this area is scribed off like this. At this fixed position only, the surveying arm is not altered, it is fixed. So at one scribing at the anterior and two scribing, one at on both the molar regions. So this is how the scribing of the the area is done. Now this is the anatomical done on the anatomic surface. The same can be done onto the land area, which can be done I'm altering this to mark onto the land area. So this can be done by scribing the cast like this. So here we are placing three marks, and this tilt, and at this same tilt only we should get like this. So at this same tilt only the master cast has to be placed. So this was the method of tripoding. Now once we have scribed this cast area, cast portion, then it has to be marked by just a small cross line, so that it is visible. the same way on this side also. Now there are two methods. Either we can directly place the carbon marker over here at a 45 degree angle and then mark the three tripod lines, or in this I have placed a undercut gauge to scribe this cast area. Now difference is that in case if these pencil marks can go off with any wetting of the cast or any other reason, then this scratches or this scribed line is retained. So this is a purpose of tripoding, where it is used to record the tilt of the horizontal tilt of the cast. Now this was the tripoding method. Once the tripoding is done, the next method is to mark the survey lines. So here I am replacing this undercut gauge by a carbon marker. Now carbon marker is used to, once the tripoding is done, the carbon marker is used to mark the survey lines. So in this is an adjacent tooth, abutment tooth where the retentive arm is planned. So here with the help of this carbon marker, I am just scribing off the line. Here I have achieved the medium survey line. Then the same, at this same position on this also, the adjacent teeth where we achieved a high survey line. Then on this premolar, again it is scribed off. So here the kind of diagonal survey line we have achieved. So the purpose of survey line is that any of the retentive tip should be the retentive tip of the retentive clasp arm will be below the survey line, whether we are going to engage the mesial undercut or the distal undercut. Now after this, the once the survey lines are marked, then the rest seat area is marked with the help of red pencil. It is marked in a solid red. For example, I am marking it over here on the distal proximal of this premolar. Now one thing to note down is that this marking has to be done at a desired or the correct size of the rest seat, so it will be more easier to design the other components of the processes. After this, the blue and the brown lines are used, as I have explained over here. The brown pencil is used to mark the metallic portions, and the red pencil to mark the blue pencil to mark the denture base area. So till this, the procedures are followed by which the undercut gauge is used to determine the undercut area. That is how much the undercut is present. So taking with the smallest undercut gauge 0.01, we are engaging it over here, and then replacing the carbon marker with an appropriate undercut gauge. So if you want to now for most of the clasp of the cobalt chromium alloy, then for that reason 0.01 inch of the undercut is adequate. So the smallest of the this undercut gauge is used. So here, with the help of this gauge, the undercut is determined. We can see over here, during determination of the undercut, the two things, the one thing has to be kept in mind, that is, the shank of the undercut gauge should be in a proper contact with the tooth surface, and also this head should be in a contact with the tooth surface. So that is how we determine the undercut area of the tooth. So in case if you are going to use a wrought wire clasp for a proper for more flexibility, then that has to be indicated with the help of pencil. If you are going to use a wrought wire clasp for this tooth, then the marking like W and W is done over this tooth surface, over this tissue surface area. So after this, the design has to be now re-examined properly with all the features what we have seen. So I'll repeat the steps again. First of all, we check the occluded diagnostic cast at three points has to be checked. First, the any interferences which are present. The black pencil is used to mark the height of the as I've explained it, the receipt area has to be marked on the land area. Then the cuspal relief which we are going to give has to be marked. Suppose for example here we have marked it onto the cuspal area and interferences if are there. Then the lingual aspect of the occluded cast has to be marked where the metallic extension has to be extended. Then after this first step, the symbol of the tooth replacement has to be marked. For example, we have marked it as an M and M for a metallic teeth if we are going to replace. And as we are commonly replacing with a denture teeth, no symbol is required for that. Then the third step is determination of horizontal tilt, which is the most important procedure during the surveying. And in that, four factors has to be kept in mind. That is a guiding plane, retentive undercut, interferences, and aesthetic. After that, the fourth step which we are going to do is a tripoding of the cast. So as I have explained, tripoding is a recording of the tilt of the cast, so that the same path of placement is kept for the master cast also. Followed by that, we scribe the survey lines with the help of the carbon marker. Then with the help of the undercut gauge, we determine the undercut area and the metallic portion, the acrylic portion, and the receipts were marked with the different pencils, that is a brown, blue, and red. So and followed by which the cast has to be re-examined properly for the designs. Thank you.